Okay, so it's a minute past, so I think we'll get started. So my name is Chris Johnson from EPCC. So I'm pleased to introduce Athanasios Mokos from the University of Manchester. He's going to be presenting some of the work he's done as part of a recently completed ECSE project. So the title of the talk is Massively Parallel OpenMP MPI Implementation of the SPH Code, Dual S Physics. As we go along, feel free to type questions into the chat and we'll try and keep an eye out for these. But if possible, I would save questions to the end. If you have any problems as you go through hearing us or anything like that, just type it into the chat and we'll see if we can sort that out. You should be able to see the slides on the screen, but again, just let us know if you have any problems. So I'd like to hand over to Athanasios now.
Hello everyone. As Chris said, my name is Athanasios Mokos and I will present now our work on the OpenMP MPI implementation. So this talk will first give you our motivation for this research, then I'll give you a brief introduction to meshless methods and especially to smooth particle hydrodynamics. Then I will then talk a bit about the message passing interface, focusing on domain division, process communication, and asynchronous communications. I will then give you some small-scale results, including runtime results. And then I'll talk a bit more about optimization. We focus on dynamic load balancing and domain decomposition, which I will expand further, looking at the Zoltan library and its decomposition algorithms. I will then give you the conclusions and some future work. I will say, however, right now that the code is not fully functioning yet. So, our primary focus as a research group here in Manchester is on violent water flows with a breaking free surface, such as wave impact, slamming, or explosive pipe flows. There are many applications for that, mostly on coastal, in defense of coastal structures or offshore structures, but we've also got applications on dam river flooding or the nuclear industry. Now, doing experiments on this kind of flows is expensive because we need we have large times, large runtimes, large scales, and so we require significant investments. So we have focused on computational methods. And the most common used computational methods are what we call mesh-based methods, such as finite difference methods or finite element methods. And in these methods, we have points on a grid which are connected. We create fixed points on a grid which are then connected to each other. These methods are robust, well-developed, and mature. And there are a lot of algorithms and models that have been adapted for every application. However, they still have some issues. The first issue is that meshing itself can be complex. This image shows the meshing around an airplane hull to calculate the flow of the air around it. And as you can see, just creating the mesh itself is a very complex task that can take up to months before you even start running the simulation. And the other thing, and the more important to us, is the formation of the flows. So we work a lot with violent free surface flows, and we have a lot of waves breaking. And the free surface in this is constantly changing. So if we use a mesh-based method, we constantly need to remesh, change the grid, and then redo the calculation, which is very time-consuming. So what we have done is move to what we call meshless methods. So we move the computation points from fixed nodes on a grid to particles, which are not connected to each other explicitly, and they are allowed to move with their own velocity and acceleration, and each particle is moving almost independently of the other. Usually for meshless methods we don't use Eulerian derivatives, but we use Lagrangian derivatives instead. These describe the rate of change not in a fixed grid but along a trajectory. The way we connect the particles instead of grid is through the local interpolation. Each particle has the properties, density, pressure of the point in the fields, and these are traveling with them. And what we do is we use the local interpolation, where we sum the value, we integrate the value of the surrounding particles to affect the properties of the particle itself. And we do this for every particle on the grid, so which is actually the advantage and the disadvantage of the methods. The advantage, because we can easily compute free surfaces without needing a mesh, and the disadvantage, because doing it for every particle when we have several million of them is quite time consuming. Now, smooth particle hydrodynamics is a Lagrangian meshless method that uses the Navier-Stokes equations in order to move the particles. It uses local interpolation to give a value to the function, and it uses what we call a weighting function. This is a function that ideally approximates a Dirac function, which we can't use in computational methods because it's infinitesimal, and the kernel functions allow us to get around that obstacle. What they do is look in a radius around the particle, which the radius called 2H, where H is a smoothing length, and take into account all the particles, all the neighboring particles that are within that radius. We then move. We then use the interpolation to create the SPH forms of the Navier-Stokes equations. You can see here for continuity and momentum. There's obviously also one for energy, but we are not using it in this work. The momentum equation also includes a model for viscosity, which is Pij, and external forces, which in our case is gravity. I'm not going to go into more detail for this right now. The one important thing to note is that there are two methods to use SPH. There's incompressible SPH, which use the Poisson equation to link the density and the pressure. But what we are using is what we call a weakly compressible SPH. This uses an equation of state, which is much faster than using the Poisson equation, but we have to allow some degree of compressibility in the fluid. Now, using SPH for real problems is a complicated task. See, the real-life applications, as I mentioned, are complex 3D flows, and the problems we want to measure are multi-scale problems with long runtimes. You can see here in this photo of coastal flooding that we have the buildings, which are obviously several meters long, but if in order to simulate the fluid properly, what we want to do is look at the individual drops, which would be centimeters, millimeters long. And to do that properly, we require about 100 million particles or more. And obviously, we want to do it as quickly as possible, otherwise there is no benefit. So the option most people have taken so far is to use the inherent parallelism of the GPU. And to do that, we have co-developed here in Manchester with the University of Vigo, Parma and Lisbon, the SPH solver dualless physics, which we have validated for violent water flows. And we have pre- and post-processing software. And for the cases we want, we also have a lot more additional capabilities. As we have webinar generators, we have a DEM model, and multi-phase models for solid and air water flows. So we call it dualless physics because it has both a CPU and a GPU component. So right now, both the GPU and the CPU are highly optimized, and they have, as I said, multiple options and pre- and post-processing tools. The GPU is obviously using the parallelism that's inherent in the GPU, while the CPU right now uses an OpenMP implementation. That means that the GPU simulates the millions of particles we want in a few hours, while the CPU takes a few months. So there is quite a discrepancy in this, and you can see it here. We have some runtime results comparing a GPU to an 8-thread OpenMP simulation. As you can see, the speedup differs depending on the GPU, but it's on the range of 15 to 20, which is quite a bit. So GPUs have been very good for us. They are ideal for embodied simulations, and they have low-cost energy consumption. However, the tools and compilers we have are far less developed than what we have for the CPUs. And right now, using double precision of the GPUs is essentially halves our available speed. And we can use multi-GPU codes to further process particles, but they are not easily portable. They need to be developed for specific hardware applications. And there's also issues with working with industrial partners. They still need convincing to invest resource and personnel because they can't take advantage of the existing infrastructure and to require a retraining of people because they use different language as well. So what we thought we are going to do is develop a CPU code which would have a similar capability to the existing GPU code, which can be used to the existing HPC installations. That would require us the ability to scale for thousands of cores, as right now a ballpoint is that about 100 cores is equivalent to GPU. As I said, we currently only have an OpenMP implementation, so we want to move to an OpenMP MPI implementation, which is our final aim here. Now, MPI, the message parsing interface, is a portable message library specification that is standardized and it's independent of the architecture we want to use. In data passing, the MPI uses what we call a distributed memory model, where each node has its own memory and is connected with the others through the network. And they exchange code through cooperative operations. And now, obviously, we already have an OpenMP implementation, so what we want to do is use the hybrid memory model, where we have multiple cores using the same memory, but they are still connected as a node to the other nodes using the MPI. Now, what we want while integrating MPI to GLS physics is to maintain the optimization and its structure, which includes the cell-linked neighbor list, which I'll talk after that. We want to keep the ease of use for any users, regardless of their qualifications. And we don't want to change how we use the SPH models. That does limit our options when creating particles and cells, of course. Obviously, we also need to introduce new features. We need to focus on updating the existing function to work with multiple nodes, and we need to build new infrastructures and files to handle the communication data transfer. Now, I mentioned before the cell-linked neighbor list. So this is an algorithm we use that optimizes the neighbor searching for the particles in SPH. What we do is divide the domain into cells, and create a link, the cell linked list, which obviously links the particles and with the cells. Then we can use that list to search for neighbor particles only at the adjacent cells, which when you have several millions of particles is a massive time saver for us. And while integrating, we have so far updated files to move from a single node to MPI. And the changes so far have been focused on loading data from the pre-processing software creating and updating the assignments of particles, and handling and integrating the new fixtures. In files I saw above, handles essentially one of these features. And we also have created new files to handle the node communication, so the creation and transfer of buffers, as well as looking to differentiate hosts and the other nodes. We also looking, and I will talk for this after that in more detail, looking at domain decomposition and Halo exchange. So for domain decomposition, what we want is we want the node to be in charge of a separate part of the domain and have its own particle cell lists. That allows us to use more particles as it greatly reduces the local and global memory footprints. And it will also allow us to run faster as it will reduce the load in its CPU core. So for the first stage, what we implemented was a one-dimensional decomposition through slices. So we separated the domain along its longer axis, and we then split that into separate nodes, trying to have a certain amount of balance between each node. But obviously, when we're looking for neighbors, there will be particles in the edge that the neighbors would be on the other node. So we want to identify the neighboring particles in another process and move them to the process we want to calculate. But we don't want to transfer the data of all potential neighbors. We don't want to transfer data of all the particles in the node. We want to transfer only the data of the potential neighbors. And for that, we use what we call a Halo system, where we transfer data only from the neighboring slice. And these particles form what we call the Halo. This is the procedure we follow on every subdomain border. Now, what we've also implemented is asynchronous communications. What we want is to minimize the waiting time for the data transfer. So what we do is first we process the neighbor list of the interior particles while we send the data of the displaced particles. Then when we compute the forces, we do it first on the interior particles and while waiting for the Halo data. And at the end, we synchronize the process while calculating the time step. Now, this is an execution for 8 processes where we have a drop falling. We have a drop falling into a border. We have checked the results and they're identical to the single node ULS physics, and they don't depend the number of processes. So we are confident the code works properly, and it's operating for both Windows and Linux. Now, when we look at small-scale runtime results, however, we see that while our runtime is reduced when we use more cores, we have a significant decrease on parallel efficiency. And we have seen that we have scalability issues that do not allow efficient computation with 100 processes or more. And the issues we have identified so far is that the one decomposition is not scalable. We haven't so far implemented load balancing, and the time step synchronization we use is not scalable. And we need to do more than 100 processes because, as I said, we need more than 100 million particles for the target problems. Now, if we look at the last point, the time synchronization, what we see is that as we increase the number of processes, also the runtime increases. The runtime of the synchronization process increases. This is opposite to the force computation, which is the other most important function in ULS physics. And they follow the opposite trend. As you can see, as one of them, as the other functions, as the time spent for the other function diminish, the time spent in synchronization is increasing. So we need to look into changing the current implementation we have. Now, going back from that to the dynamic load balances, obviously, as you saw with the drop, parting processes do not have the same workloads. In that example, only the processes that have had the drop did anything, while the rest pretty much were sitting idly. And the simulation we have are quite dynamic, so the workload of each process is changing constantly. So we need to use what we call dynamic load balancing, which is to transfer particles essentially, or like computational duties to the other nodes. And there are two ways to do that, having the same number of particles in each domain or the same execution time. The first option is simpler to enforce, but option two does have higher potential. Now, if we do have the decomposition, so you could apply load balancing in that, but as you can see in this example, even if we move the computation, if we move the slice to the other, we don't really alleviate the problem much. So what we have looked instead is using the .Zoltan data management library, which is a library for the development and optimization of parallel codes, and it is scalable up to a million cores. That includes some things that are very important to us. It includes special decomposition and load balancing algorithms and the communication packets. You can see to the right Zoltan being used in an SPH simulation. This is from a previous ECSC project. And what we're going to use from the Zoltan library is the decomposition algorithm called the Hilbert space filling curve. This is a continuous fractal space filling curve, and you can see here for the first six instances in 2D, which maps 2D and 3D points to a 1D curve. The most important part for us is that it maintains spatial locality. Since we're looking for neighbors, having the particles that are close to each other being close in the memory as well is it creates quite an improvement in our runtimes. The only problem is that we have an increased complexity of data transfer because of the irregular subdomain shapes. Now, how do we use the Hilbert space filling curve? What that does is that we apply a curve to the domain, and that divides the curve into n bins, where n is larger than the amount of processes. So on the example of the right, if say we had two processes, we would split it into three bins. That then we calculate the weights we want from the starting point, and we cut off whenever we have the desired weights. We then can refine only the bins that that contain the cutting off points, while leaving the other bins alone. When we achieve the desired balance, we can then send this data to the separate nodes. So we want to use the Hilbert space filling curve both for domain composition and load balancing. We are not going to use the particles as the main partitioning parameter, but the cells. They have a significantly smaller number than particles. They are constant throughout the computation, and they allow for an easier load balancing. And what we can do is use cell weights, look at the number of particles that are in each cell, and determine the weights we need for the Hilbert space filling curve. And we are going to use an automatic migration system to transfer the cell data between each node. So for that, we have created new arrays containing the global and the local cell ID and the coordinates of the cells. Each process holds only its local data. And you can see here on the right side an example with a small number of particles and a small number of cells. So what we do is we initially split, and this is the global cell IDs of each cell. So what we do in this case is we first split the domain by one D decomposition, and we then look at from which we can get the local cell ID for each node. We then look at creating cell weights. So we look at the number of particles in each cell, and we divide that by the total number of particles. And we send the cell ID data and the cell weights to Zoltan. After that, we apply the Hilbert space filling curve. Zoltan applies the space filling curve and gives us back the IDs and of imported and exported cells, and the process in which they are being sent. That allows us then to move to update the global cell ID and transfer the cells from one process to the other. And along with them, we also import and export the particles that are in them. We then reorder the data, creating a new cell linked neighbor list, and we update the local cell ID. Obviously, that is quite an involved process, so this is not applied every time step, but only when the imbalance calculated by the cell weights exceeds 20%. Now, obviously, when we do the cell the load balancing with the cells, so we need a way to map the cells and particles. For that, we're using the cell part array within DualS Physics, which is essentially the cell linked list. And we can easily map that on the local cell ID, which will act then as an intermediary between the cell linked list, which is local, and the global cell ID. The reason we need an intermediary here is because the linked list is a more complicated array, as it separates between border particles, fluid particles, floating body particles, and it also has special cells for looking at particles that exit the system. Now, as I mentioned, the particles need reordering. Currently, we reorder the particle with the same algorithm we use for the single node, the ones you saw with the 1D decomposition, which makes easier mapping to the cell part array. But a better option would be to reorder along the space filling curve. That would improve our runtime and allow us to maintain the special locality we want. So the final reordering particle would look essentially like that. Now, if we look at the partition results, what we have here is a dam break case where we have water volume, which is the blue, that's being left to fall along a box. And if we look at the 1D decomposition, that would be the way we split the domain. So as you can see, half of our processes do nothing here. If we apply Zoltan, however, we have a much different. If we apply space filling curve, the domain is much different. As you can see, 7 of the processes are concentrated on the fluid, while one takes account of the boundaries as well as the empty cells. And we have also applied that to 3D models, such as here, where applying Zoltan creates this type of cell. And you can see 3D is a bit more difficult to show, but you can see the how the domain is split in more detail here. Unfortunately, as I said, the code isn't fully working yet. What we're missing is the interaction between the nodes, so the halo exchange I mentioned before and moving the particles from one node to the other. So this is essentially our next step. After that, we need to assess the capabilities of the code and its scalability and look at the optimization. As I said, looking especially at the time synchronization issue. After that, we need to look at new input output functions. So I have run the code for a lot more cores, but we need to process each core separately, which is why you only see results from 8 processes. After that, we want to look at to actually run the real problems we want to execute them to large HPC clusters. So for the Halo exchange, we can, to a certain point, reuse what we did with the UAND decomposition. However, we can't use the geometric way we did with the slices. We need to split the particles. We need to look at each cell individually. This will be done through the global cell ID, but as I said, hasn't implemented yet. A similar procedure will be done for the particle exchange, where the particles will be checked only for the cells in the edge of the partitions, but they need to be cells independently rather than slices. Right. So this is pretty much all I wanted to say. These are my references, and thank you for your attention.
So thank you very much, Athanatios. So does anybody have questions? If so, then you can either speak into the, put your microphone on and speak, or just type something into the chat and we can relay it. So I don't know if you just saw there's a question there. So Arno's asking how you found using Zoltan. Did you find it was well documented?
To a certain degree. I think there is a good documentation of what the different functions do, but there's very few examples of how to actually use them within existing program. Like, how can I use my existing buffers with Zoltan? That was something I had to figure out. But there is a lot of documentation of what the individual function do.
Thank you.
And I also found it easier using Zoltan for Linux rather than Windows, which we have the existing code mostly in Windows because that's where most of the GPU debugging has been.
So it was very interesting because when people normally talk about combining MPI and OpenMP, they have an MPI program and they introduce OpenMP on a node. Whereas you had a GPU and OpenMP program that you introduced MPI into. Is there any OpenMP, sorry, maybe I missed it. Is there any OpenMP left in your current implementation, or is it pure MPI? I had a couple of connection problems, so I missed a couple of your slides, but.
So
your final MPI code.
The final MPI code is, should have the I have le, the there is the existing OpenMP functionality but it has been disabled so far with the Zoltan. I haven't used it to have the program simpler and not have issues with any OpenMP MPI so far. I have disabled it with Zoltan. It is used for the small scale application.
Okay, and is the OpenMP parallelization done by parallelizing over particles, or does it use a domain decomposition like you have for MPI? I just want to
it's over particles. It's over particles, so it's not. The OpenMP is sort of in a smaller and not scale. What's the worst? Not a coarse grained application. It's a more fine grained approach. So we look at the force computation in more detail, while OpenMP is more for transferring data rather than doing the application itself.
Okay. So when you get a working MPI code, you think you should be able to turn the OpenMP back on and it should still work?
Yes.
Okay, that's interesting. Thanks.
So there was a question by Dan.
Mm-hmm.
So the So the particle in cell is also a similar MSless method, similar to SPH. Yes, essentially. SPH is more widely used for our applications, though SPH is more widely used because we don't want to do the cells. Essentially, the cells are not used in the computation. They are only there for to get a neighbor list faster.
Okay, and there was also a question from William. I'll just read it out in case people aren't looking at the chat. So he said, thank you for the talk. It looked like your cells were based on all the particles having the same smoothing length, H, rather than allowing them to vary. Is that the case?
Yes. So when doing SPH, we have found that having the same H for all particles leads to a better consistency throughout, better consistency in the application. Using H, we have found leads to errors, especially in the domain in when you have neighbors with different H's. There is additional functions you need to take into account, and for a lot of cases, a lot of people in SPH have found these don't work as well as a constant H.
Thank you. So, are there any more questions?
I was just interested in your, you had an interesting figure at the start where you said that you thought that the GPU implementation was equivalent to about 100 CPU cores, is that correct?
Yes, for a dualist physics at least.
Right. Have you any idea how the cost comparison works there? You know, that sounds to me like it is more efficient on the GPU that it would be with that implementation. It would be with the original one, which maybe didn't scale so well. That if it's 100 CPUs equals one GPU, that would seem like the GPU would be reasonably cost efficient. I said I'm not exactly sure what the price structure is, but it sounds
so
like
yes. So one of the benefits of the GPU is that it's cheaper. Like. You can get a consumer grade GPU for like £500, which so will run a few million particles. The only limit there is that the GPUs have quite limited memory compared to the CPUs. Like a consumer grade GPU has at most 4 GB. Which usually enough for about 20 million particles, and even the higher grade GPUs, the Tesla series, have 12 gigabytes. So you can run 100 million particles, but obviously there's the cost there is about £3,000, I think. I don't know the cost about creating a 100 CPU system though, so I can't compare directly. Benefit moving to HPC
I just want to check I had those numbers right.
Okay, so thank you very much, Athanasios, for your talk. It was very interesting. So that ends the session now. I'm sure any questions, then you can get in touch with Athanasios directly, or you can just email us into the help desk and we can pass it on. Okay, so thank you very much for your time, and thanks for the talk.
Thank you for the attention.